We're back. We're live. This is ThinkTech and Community Matters. And today we have Russell Honda. He's going to talk about rail. We're calling it a big week for rail. We've got to sort out what's going on in rail. So much is happening. I've been in coverage in the Star Advertiser and Civil Beat, PBN. That's all around town. But from Russell, we're going to find out exactly what's going on. Welcome to the show, Russell.
Yeah, thank you, Jay, for inviting me for ThinkTech. You know, today's my good subject for me, the rail project. As you know, I have like 30 years experience in transportation and planning, being an engineer as well. And I had retired from state DOT, which I was a statewide planner on the 1990 project, which I drafted all the communication letters back then with Governor John Wahey. Mm-hmm. So I'm very familiar with the situation with rail project.
And you're a transportation consultant right now as we speak, yeah?
Yes, sir. And matter of fact, I did represent Mitsubishi Sumitomo when they had the core systems contract. And back then, we were going to build the train here locally and have manufacturing here. And we were going to do that at the Mililani Technology Park and use the local unions and assemble it and deliver the train. And on top of that, we were going to train the workers and build electric cars after that. So I kind of showcased them when we had the first Hawaiian Auto Show, and I was able to talk to the Mitsubishi Motors people in California, and they said, yeah, we can bring the Mitsubishi I, the electric car from England. It was a prototype to showcase for the first Hawaiian Auto Show. And I wanted to let the public officials and the people at the heart who was involved with the rail project say, hey, this is what they can offer after we built the train here. We'll build electric car to meet the energy plan for year 2045, mm-hmm. being a fossil fuel. So we had it all.
Pretty good. Too bad.
Yeah, it didn't work out according to the plans. But as you know, today at the legislature, they're trying to revive the
Let's talk about what happened this week. I know Monday was the Senate hearing. Tell me, what happened? Who was there? What's going on?
Okay, I guess as you know, you read in the newspaper, it's been in the press as well in the news. I guess they're going to try to wrap it up today, being Friday, September 1st.
Start at the beginning now. What happened on, the 28th?
Okay, the Senate introduced a Senate Bill 4, which had a combination of increasing the funding source. For either you go with the transit accommodation tax, which the hotel people and the tourists will pay, and as you know, the general excise tax, which with the local consumption, the majority will be paid by the local residents here. So what happened with the legislature when they had the press release with both the House and the Senate with Rep. Speakers Scott Sike and the Senate President Ron Cochi, and they kind of agreed and they came up with a measure of how they're going to combine both the TAT and the general excise tax. Like the transit accommodation, they want to increase for 13 years, an increase from 9.25% to 10.25%, increasing 1% of the TAT for 13 years. Mm-hmm. And they assume they're going to generate roughly about $1.3 billion. On the general excise, they want it to increase 3 years. From year 2027 to 2030. So that generates roughly about 1.1. So when you combine both the TAT and the general excise, you get about $2.4 billion additional funds of whatever the HART has in their budget right now. And if you look at their balance sheet, I guess there was a shortfall of $300 million, which they had to raise through their obligation bonds that the city council passed, because they got to meet the threshold to go to the middle street. As you know, with the projection cost, after they gave the contractor, the prime contractor, Simic, Taylor & Grant, which it used to be under Kiewit Pacific, but Kiewit Pacific pulled out and they didn't want to bid on the third phase going from Pearl City for the Arizona Memorial Site, where Pearl Harbor is after the Aloha Stadium. You can see the viaduct being cut towards the airport. And from that area, Simic, Taylor, and Grant got the contract.
That's the contract, okay.
And that was estimated by about $640 million. And they started the work in airport area. But to me, what's the biggest problem is if you go with the new prime contractor have to re-educate their subcontractors. They got to buy new equipment. They don't even have the precast.
It's a real problem, is it? Because all the startup kind of experience.
Exactly. That's where you're going to double cost of.
That's too bad. So why did Kiewit really drop out?
I think the rumors I heard was because of, like, came in the press is that because of the cost overrun and the change order, the HART owed Kiewit $100 million
from the program. That's a lot.
And prior to that, you know, the CART was always kind of antagonizing the Kiewit, saying with the change order and the cost overrun, they're
fighting,
taking advantage
of the
project.
Orders.
So they're kind of not cooperating much. And what happened was during negotiation time for the change order, Kiewit got kind of upset because the HART board or the HART didn't want it to pay Kiewit the additional $100 million, which they own from the cost overruns in the change order. So that's the reason Kiewit didn't want it to bid.
They didn't want to pay the $100 million.
Yeah, exactly. So they pulled
out. So they're trying to negotiate on it or just say no?
They just said no and they pulled out. And
I would pull out for $100 million and they didn't get paid yet, huh?
Exactly.
Going to be litigation over?
I'm not sure what's going to happen on the that side, but the legality side, but I think that's what we awarded the contract to Cemig-10 grant for the third phase.
Must have lost some time on that, too.
Exactly, and what's the problem? From the third phase, that contract is only up to Middle Street, and it requires under the FTA's minimum operating segment, under the locally preferred alternative, that you got to go to the Middle Street no matter what. But now the FTA is saying that you got now, with additional funding that you guys are going to come with the recovery plan and the financial plan that they have to meet by September 15. That's what the legislature is always, you know.
That's why the special session was at the end of August and beginning of September.
Yeah, because they have to meet the financial plan and the state, the management recovery plan. They have to submit by September
15. How does this affect option 2A? I'm not sure where that stands in all this. It's kind of a hanging issue. Option 2A is the one ground level, you know, from Middle Street to downtown. Save a lot of money.
Right. But I think the technology is going to be different. With you're going to retrofit some of the the third rail concept.
You don't think that's going to happen?
I don't think, because you're still going to be traffic. You know, you're going to block traffic. If you're on a fixed sky rail, elevated, you know, there's no hindrance of blocking the passage or anything. It's going to be on time, on schedule.
Yeah.
And there will be no gridlock.
So option 2A, you don't think it's going to happen?
Then you got to change the EIS and everything, and that's going to
more
take
delay.
That'll be another 18 months or 2 years of approving the environmental impact statement.
Yeah,
so even you do
that.
A supplemental on that one, I don't think it's because FTA prefers the fixed sky rail and the elevated concept.
Okay, so on Monday, you said it was Bill 4, and it's a special session, you know, and there was only one issue. I mean, I know there were some confirmations, and they did, in fact, confirm Jay Griffin on the PUC. Mostly, it was about rail. How do we get to Bill 4 if it's only about rail? What about Bill 1, 2, and 3? What happened?
I think there were kind of ones that was they didn't include some of the trade-offs with the neighbor islands. I know there was even today when I was, there was a big concern at the legislature is that the state senators and the House of Representatives are not working together with the neighbor island county, with the county council. And
okay, so there was a move now to get to tax the GET, and maybe the TAT affects the whole state, yeah?
Right.
And the GET, they're trying to make the GET extension statewide or just Honolulu?
Actually, they wanted to do it for statewide, but they're given an option for each county to pass a measure in a county council. So right now, the statewide taxes on the GET is 4.5% that we pay in Oahu. But if you go to the county, they only pay 4% under the rule. But some of them pay like 4.2, and Oahu might.
So you're saying that it would have had to have a resolution or a bill by each county agreeing that this tax would come out of that county? Why would they do that? What's in it for them to increase tax on their people for a system that has no effect on them?
Exactly. That's why the neighbor island delegates or the representatives and state senators are against this bill, because they thinking that neighbor island is not going to benefit. They have to pay for the Oahu's mismanagement of the rail project.
Politically, I can't imagine why they would agree.
So I came up with a good measure of see if we can mitigate this and work together with, because we're all together as a statewide. Myself being a statewide planner, you know, I've seen the infrastructure of harbors, airports, and highways on all the islands on a statewide basis. So I know what the needs and wants of each counties and islands are like, and it's not like Oahu. neighbor islands are having more trouble with their infrastructure needs and the revenue sources are like Oahu. Like we have 80% of populations in Oahu, so we're a bigger player here. Mm. So I can see why the neighbor islands are not seeing what we are seeing from Oahu.
Okay, so what happened to that idea? You know, the idea of making statewide TAT, that's probably easy because hotels are everywhere and they serve every county. But also the GET statewide. So how did that sort out on Monday?
Well, I think today's going to be the final vote.
But how did it sort out on Monday?
On Monday, the hotel people are against it. I know the Hawaii Hotel Association, Hawaii Tourism
Authority.
Their authority as well was there testifying, and they're against it because they don't want to pass the buck to the tourists already. They're already paying. But if you look at from the corporate structure, the corporate tax is 35%, and the corporations of the hotelers can have a lot of tax write-offs. So I think from the federal tax write-off to the state tax write-off, they got to give a little incentive because they did increase the TAT.
Okay, so what came out of the Senate committee? I guess it was the Senate committee on Monday. What was the result of that in Bill 4?
I think the Senate committee decided to pass the measure.
Increase the TAT?
Not
a statewide increase, or was it a statewide increase?
They're going to leave it up to the TAT. I think it was $94 million is existing for giving it to three counties, Kauai, Maui, and Big Island. And they were going to give it 10 more million, so they're going to get like $104 million, close to $105, to the neighborhood. So they have to break that into three counties.
Then give them money out of the goes back to the county.
Exactly,
it's a deal.
Yeah, it's a deal. So in other words, they're going to get additional $10 million for increasing of the TAT. Of
1%. Okay, so it passed that way, Bill 4 on Monday. What happened since Monday?
Okay, since Monday there have been a lot of. I think my hunch, what I just observed today, and what I heard from the floor legislators.
It's going on right now.
Exactly right now.
Here on a Friday afternoon.
Exactly.
At
it started 10 o'clock this morning, and the Senate passed it by noontime, and the House is still debating on the floor. And I guess they're giving every legislator a chance to do a rebuttal on it on the Senate.
So what's being said? What does it look like?
I think they're going to pass it. The bottom line.
What happened on Monday. That's going
to
get passed.
I think prior to
Bill
that.
Four.
I think the deal was already made when Senate President Kochi and Speaker Scott Sikey made a press release, and they thought this is the best measure and approach in this way. So they just have to go through the process right now, the legislative process, having three readings on both sides to pass the measure.
So the hotels have settled down. They're willing to take the TAT, I guess? Or at least they shot their wad.
Exactly.
They made their points, and now this legislature is ruling. And the GET thing has worked out with the counties where we know how much they're going to get back out of the money that's collected.
Yeah, I think from the hotel's point of view, what might happen is if they want to pass, they don't want to pass the buck to the tourists, they can lower their rack rates and the wholesale price and try to make up with it.
Well,
and
they've been increasing rates
lately somehow
anyway.
Do some kind of
and they're
corporate
in a boom
tax write-off
time anyway, so I understand the legislature looking at them. Mm-hmm. It's a source of revenue. This is so highly political, honestly. So you think it'll pass today?
Yes, definitely. I think it's we do need some kind of measure by September 15th.
Satisfy the FTA.
Yes, that's what I remember when our Congresswoman Colleen Hanabusa was mentioned. She had some great insight about that, and she's our representative from the congressional side with Senator Brian Schatz as well.
Yeah.
So they have our insight.
She's familiar because she was part of HART for a while.
Exactly, and they got to be loved. And the other thing is our FTA. Director is going to be changing. They're going to be rotating September, sometime in the middle of September. So we will have a new FTA director.
What's the change going to mean? I mean, different agencies, different results, but this administration is appointing different kinds of people, yeah?
Yeah, I think from the Secretary of Transportation, Len Char, she's been pretty much behind the White House with Donald Trump, so we've been trying to
it's going to be easier or harder to get money from them going forward with this change. What do you think?
I think, you know, as long as Hawaii can maintain status quo and obtain federal funds, I think we're in good shape.
Okay.
That was one of my suggestions to the state legislature when the changing of the guards with when Donald Trump came, that we don't want to bridge the gap there and you know, make sure that we maintain our federal funds here. Because the state budget requires, like, we have like 20% of all the state budget is federal funds.
Okay. Well, we've looked at the legislature this week. We've seen the two major hearings. We've heard about the players involved. We've heard the likely result. We'll have to follow that up with you. We're going to, you know, we're going to close this show now, and we're going to come back in a minute and do another segment on what it means and how it looks going forward from a business point of view, from a regulatory point of view, from a heart point of view. So thank you very much, Russell. We'll see
you
in a minute with our next show, all right?
Sure.